Well, the big question tonight remains whether or not the Japanese are telling us the truth about the crisis at that dangerously crippled Fukushima nuclear plant. A growing number of experts worldwide are beginning to wonder. Earlier today, for instance, we learned that the top US atomic expert has warned that radiation levels in the area are, quote, extremely high, and he's advised Americans to get out of there fast. As well, more has emerged today about the Tokyo Energy Power Company, the owners of this nuclear mess. Back in 2002, they had to apologise for dodgy safety practices and for trying to cover them up. Here's Emily Rice.
As military water bombers attempt to cool the overheating reactors, a fog of information still clouds the nuclear catastrophe. International experts have finally confirmed there has been a partial meltdown at the Fukushima Daiichi plant.
The situation at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant is very serious. Damage to the cores of the three units, Unit 1, Unit 2 and 3, has been confirmed.
The aerial operation aims to keep the hot fuel rods submerged underwater to prevent radioactivity being released from exposure to air. It's a last resort measure to prevent overheating with cooling systems crippled, multiple explosions and radiation leaks since the earthquake and tsunami last weekend. While the Japanese Prime Minister has made infrequent statements about the crisis, the Emperor has now made a rare public address to express his concerns. Nuclear experts in the United States are also speaking out, concerned the situation is far more dire than authorities are revealing, and that the country is on the brink of total meltdown.
And we believe that radiation levels are extremely high, which could possibly impact the ability to take corrective measures.
And there are conflicting reports, and so we don't really know in detail what's happening.
The United States is now organising a charter flight to retrieve Americans from the country. The Australian government has ordered Australians within 80 kilometres to stay indoors and, if possible, get out of the country altogether. Peter Williams and his heavily pregnant wife are heeding the advice, fleeing their home near the plant and flying back to Queensland tonight.
It's heartbreaking and it's hard. There's a sense of guilt and responsibility, but at the end of the day, it's health and life that's more important.
He says uncertainty is fueling the panic.
They're waiting in like supermarket queues for 2.5 hours just to buy some food. And maybe if you get some, there's no fuel for your car. Everything's rationed.
And he feels for those left behind.
I'm very worried about the radiation. I keep up with the news and the situation seems to be getting worse.
We can't see the radiation, and even the tiniest amount could affect our health.
Despite the chaos, many Australian firms are yet to withdraw their staff and some are happy to stay.
At this stage, we're not particularly worried. If it did become dangerous where we live, we'd probably move to another part of Japan that's further away.
Japanese residents here are also feeling the strain from a lack of information.
All we can do is just pray. I know that the people working there are literally risking their lives, but we haven't heard any news of improvement so far.
While the world reacts to a potential nuclear fallout, hundreds of thousands of people in the surrounding tsunami zone are just struggling to survive, freezing and almost forgotten.
Emily Rice there. Well, a short time ago, I spoke to CNN reporter Stan Grant from Tokyo on what clearly is a worsening situation for both the people of Japan and Japanese nuclear authorities. Stan, good to talk to you again. Before we talk about how they're going with cooling down those towers, today we discover that the Americans are clearly at odds with the Japanese on this whole issue. Their regulatory authority over there is saying that the situation is extremely high, the danger, the radiation's high, and in fact it will worsen, the situation will worsen. Is that message getting through in Japan?
It's an interesting disagreement, isn't it, between two old allies, very, very close allies, George, the US and Japan. Well, what we're hearing here, as you identified, there are US officials saying that It's focusing on the number four reactor. You recall that that's where the pool of water is that houses the spent fuel rods. They're not as protected right. as the rods that are in working order and contained within the reactor and the containment vessels. They're exposed. Now, they're saying that water level is low, exposing those reactors, and that's why the radiation levels should be much higher and, in fact, will go much higher. The Japanese are saying no. They've flown over there today. They've dumped water in the area. They're saying that they've been able to see from their choppers that there is, in fact, water inside that pool. They're denying that the radiation levels are that high, and they're saying that the radiation levels, by and large, have not been at an extent that it would do damage to humans. So there is a big disagreement there.
What's your take on it, Stan? I mean, do you think it's deliberate dishonesty, lack of transparency, deceit, or is it ignorance? Is it a fact that they are in disarray and just don't know?
Not ignorance, because, you know, this is a... Look, we're talking about a highly sophisticated country here. A country up until recently was the number two economy in the world, a technological giant, one of the most nuclearised countries in the world. So they certainly know about how these plants operate. And let's not forget, despite the earthquake and the tsunami, the plant was still standing. They are dealing with the residual effect of that, but it certainly didn't take it out completely. So they certainly understand what they're doing. I think at the moment there is a massive number of issues that they're dealing with. Fires, explosions, radiation levels peaking, partial meltdowns within the core of the reactor, moving 200,000 people, establishing a 20-kilometre no-go zone. Limited number of workers. You know, there were 50 workers trying to pull this all together there yesterday. They've moved that number out to 180. And then you have so many different bodies giving information at different times of the day. It's a house on fire, and you're wondering what to save next. What's the first thing to save? It really is that sort of an analogy, George.
Yeah, the other thing that's emerged today, Stan, is the talk about the Tokyo Power Company, the owners of the reactor in question, in the past have actually falsified safety data and went further and were dishonest and tried to hide the fact that they had. I mean, that's certainly not going to encourage people and make them feel confident about the way this problem's being handled.
That's where the issue of trust comes in. You know, people want hard answers. We get a lot of information at various times of the day. We hear about radiation levels, but what does that mean? We hear about radiation turning up in the drinking water in Fukushima. They say it's still safe to drink, but you're going to take that risk? Whose word are you going to believe? You're going to let your children drink that water? This is the problem, you see, when you have such an information flow, but no real hard information, no real hard data, then people fill that gap, that information gap, with a lack of trust and a lot of fear. And yes, you're right, it has a spotty record when it comes to the truth, when it comes to being full and frank. And let's face it, governments around the world at various times have been accused of the same thing.
You're dead right, Stan. They wouldn't be the first government in the world to not exactly tell us the truth all the time. But thanks for that, and at least it's not snowing where you are.